My voice?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, and students, you are very most welcome to this kind of great, in fact, occasion to host our friend and Al Jazeera presenter, Rawaa Augé, as part of Al Jazeera speaker series. Now we are going to resume the series, hopefully, starting from this one and then the next semester. I will introduce Rawaa kind of in detail, but I thought maybe one of the best ways to start this session is to have a clip showing Rawaa in action as way of introduction. Then I'm going to tell you a little bit about her CV.
هي الكشف عن الخبر أينما كان. الجرأة في طرح التغيير. الخبر أولا معي أنا رعاء أوجي. تابعونا.
Okay, thanks Dan. Well, this is just to see Rawaa again in action. Sorry for those who don't speak the language. Basically, it's kind of very short promo about the news delivery at Al Jazeera. Now, Rawaa, well, maybe this is not now, Dan. This is not now, please. Yeah, if you can. Yeah, sorry about this kind of very technical hiccup. Rawaa is a news presenter at Al Jazeera Arabic since 2014, and before this she did work for France 24 for 4 years, I guess, from 2010 to 2014. Then before joining the field of the media, she was in management, and her job, I think, was headhunting.
Yeah.
And then lately she was herself headhunted by the media people. She stayed in France, and then from Paris she moved to Doha and joined Al Jazeera in 2014. In terms of education, which is something really very interesting to see how Rawaa's background is very solid in liberal arts, whereas Sandra, my boss, just kind of emphasized this dimension in reading journalism and communication. Rawaa obtained 3 degrees, the first one in mass communication and journalism from the university, the Lebanese university. Then the second one was a master's degree from the Balmain University in mass communication. Then in France, while doing her job with France 24, she did another master's degree in geopolitics. So she has a kind of diverse and solid background in different areas. Now, the format of our meeting, as usual, it's kind of conversation-based talk, very informal. I'm going to lead some questions with Rawaa, ask her about her experience, the combination of, if you like, a French, Arabic background and experience in the different newsrooms, and then we are going to open the floor for your questions and reflections. So get ready and pencil down whatever thoughts or questions you want to ask. Now, Rawaa, uniquely you combine this kind of French and Arabic experience in a newsroom. Then you started in the media after some short period of time in this management thing. Can you tell us, because we really want to know your kind of career profile, so to inspire our students and inform us. How did it all start from Lebanon after finishing your education?
I was actually working during my university degree, so it was all sorts of jobs that a student can find, student work. And then when I finished my first bachelor in journalism, I was offered a job at a TV station in Lebanon, and the salary was like half the salary I was getting as a student, because I didn't have the right people to know. Because I don't know if you have an idea about Lebanon, it's basically very partisan, bipartisan media. So this goes for Hariri side, this is for Hezbollah side. And so I figured that I will be less paid and be labeled with one side than the other. So I decided to go for management and get the money. So I became a headhunter then. It was interesting also because it was, journalism is more about curiosity, and that's, I think, the key point in journalism for me. And headhunting was research all the time. You have to think how to find the right people for this job. It was managerial positions for something very delicate. I would have never imagined to know so much about petrochemical industry, for example, in Saudi Arabia. Sometimes I had to find someone who would know exactly how to produce a kind of carpet from petrochemicals, so it was interesting to find. And this is, by the way, more impressive than the camera, all these people this close.
That's
from
where
me.
You have the money, real money.
Usually, yeah, I don't imagine people in front of me. I just see the camera and say hi. So this is impressive. So then I wanted to move to France for personal reasons, and I told myself that this is my chance to try to get back to my field, because I really love journalism. And I thought to myself that if I apply for France 24, as someone who's an Arabic speaker and who's trilingual also, I could be interesting. And my bet was in its right place. So they took me. We had a general knowledge test that I had people from the European Commission that I had to memorize all the names before. I didn't know them before. I knew only Catherine Ashton, and then I had to know all the sorts of people. But I passed the test, and I got in. I got in as an intern because I was a university student. I was doing my master's in geopolitics.
So was there any test to do with your, let's say, Arabic skills? Because that was on, I think, general knowledge, you said?
Yes, there was general knowledge, and there were Arabic. Okay. And actually, that was one of the key points that helped me get in France 24 Arabic, because I had a good Arabic, and they had a problem with people who were brought up in France. They didn't have the same level of Arabic as people who are native here. So it helped me get in. And I started really like at the bottom of you should carry the papers and bring all the contacts and interview people. So I told myself, okay, I'm starting from zero. I'm 26. It's not too late yet. It's my chance to make the best out of it. And I just wanted to prove that I have editorial vision. So I was just sometimes trying to bring to the attention of my editor-in-chief that this could be interesting news for us, and if we deal with it from this angle and not. And quickly they decided that I have what it takes to be a journalist, a real journalist. So they moved me to the report, and I started editing reports. I still love editing a lot. And I love doing reports because it's something like a puzzle. It's very interesting. And so I started with that. And
was there a kind of big difference? Because I would presume that you have, let's say, the skills back at the university years, that you learned some editing skills. And then now, yeah, the first time for you to put this in.
How it goes for you here. But from my experience, what I learned at university was really like 5% of what I needed. It was because the software is different. Even now, for example, we are just launching a new software at Al Jazeera. So everyone who's been working for 15 years now has to learn a new software again, a new techniques and so on. So it's always, I felt, I had one professor who told me the first day of university, everything, the maximum we will be able to give you is 20% of what you will use in real life. And I found it very true because they gave us the basics, like how to spot images, how to create a report. But then all the techniques, they change all the time. So in terms of editorial, that's where the university came in. That's where I had the skills to show that I can spot where the news on how to treat it, how different angles. This is where the university for me was very important. But in terms of skills like editing and so on, I had to restart all over. But of course, when you have an idea of what it takes to make a VT report for TV and what it takes to make a good promotion or a good video, then this is the base.
Well, this is, I think, I guess for me and maybe for our students is very informative. That is, the differentiation between technical skills and editorial skills that you need to, at the end of the day, you need to have very solid skills and the qualities when it comes to the editorial line, and then how, what kind of a story that you need to pick, and in what time, and in what context as well. So this makes you as well, I think, kind of having an edge over others within the newsroom of France 24.
I think also, so that people don't misunderstand me, it's very important to pass through the academic, because I see the difference with people. We have some people who are wonderful editors. They would make the best movie ever, but sometimes it doesn't serve the journalism thing you want to show, the journalism story you want to show. So this is where my academic background comes in, and I really see the difference between people's backgrounds at work. We have lots of people who weren't journalists, and I see how, for us, those who are doing journalism in a way, or at least had part of journalism in their courses and their academic studies, they see the importance of guidelines and ethics, especially ethics in this world today, mm-hmm, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is great so far. Then when and how did you join the presenting? Because I think this is going to be a huge step in your career as well. So you started like a journalist, then reporter, yeah, then the big move is to be on the screen.
Yeah, I'm officially now the presenter. So basically, I'm the girl who makes her hair and puts the makeup on and gets dressed well. And I didn't want that. I didn't want to be labeled as the bimbo in a way, because that's what I am now. And there was one more thing.
No, you are deeper than this.
I try. There was this issue also. At my work, my boss was trying to tell me all the time, I want you to try the presenting. And I was like, no, I don't want to get crazy. Because I felt like everyone who would go on screen, they have this certain ego, and they become like stars. And then when they walk in, they have to put the shades on. And I just felt like this is not the journalism I love. This is putting barriers between me and the stories and me and the people. So I just told him I prefer to stay insane and get paid less. And that's it. And then slowly he started actually to attract me towards the TV by telling me, we had something that we don't see here at Al Jazeera. We had at France 24 something called The Chronicle, where it's actually the journalist who's doing the work. Instead of bringing an expert or someone outside to analyze, you're following up the story. Just go on air and talk about it for 5 minutes, just like a reporter. So I started doing that, and then he was like, you see, you're good on screen. I said, that's still not the problem. The problem is I don't want to lose my mind. And then one day, we had lots of people on vacation, and we had some people who got sick, and he said, you have no choice. You have to go on air in 10 minutes. And I remember that I just got in. I had very bad hair anyway, and I wasn't well prepared. And I remember that when the music started, they start with the headline. We don't see the presenter. And for like 10 seconds, I didn't say anything. And I was just thinking, just unplug and leave the studio, and then they can manage it themselves. But I didn't unplug. The girl, and I had a good colleague, and she was very nice, and she said, you can do it. Some people who are way less interesting than you, they do it. And yeah. So I started talking. I figured out that, yes, I can still talk. And
so do you regret that moment of unplugging that wire?
Actually, no, because I figured out that it was a lot of bad perception of the presenter. It was really, there are true some colleagues who have their ego, but they can have it also in any other career, and that's, I've seen that in my previous job. It's just a personal nature. It's not the camera that changes people, it's people themselves. And I came to like it, especially when I was interviewing some very interesting people, or when I had breaking news. I love breaking news, and the way that you follow the stories and so on. So no, I don't regret it. I still don't like the makeup, though.
That's very good. Now, Rawaa, if I take you kind of deeper into the newsroom, at, you know, France 24. That is to do with the culture, because this is something that we are going to discuss now. This is the comparison between, you know, France 24 and Al Jazeera. Then you have maybe kind of different culture when it comes to covering the news, the delivery. Some people would say you have an editorial line in France 24 as you have it in Russia Today, for example, or Al Hurra, which is very close to the foreign policy of the state where you have the station. Then you have Al Jazeera, they claim and they say, well, we don't have any editorial line, maybe like the BBC culture. It's about, you know, covering the news objectively from different sides and telling all the stories of any news item. So let's kind of focus on the so-called the news culture in that place, France 24.
Well, this could be a PhD study, by the way, because it's very long. The culture is very different, but let me first start with the idea that France 24 as the voice of France, it was, when it was launched, that was the idea of the prime minister who launched it. But the French system and the French way of journalism, French television, the public one, is basically like BBC. It's funded by the people, so it's for the people and not for the government. So apart from really very specific situations where we were not allowed to talk, reveal the hostages' names, and if their situation, if they've been killed or freed, until the Ministry of Foreign Affairs would say so, that was the only time when we had people intervening. But of course we had sometimes when we would feel that we have to comply with the French policy, and I will talk about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict because that's a very interesting case. But the culture in itself, it's very different. And journalism in France is also very different from the UK. They consider French people as rude and obscene sometimes, because they have values that are different. They have things that are very normal in France, but they're not.
Any example?
Yeah,
rudeness
obscene, especially a scene. When the feminine ladies started protesting.
What's
with
the feminine? Maybe some
the
people.
The feminine are those militants, female feminist militants who protest with their breasts uncovered, nude, basically. In the U.S., for example, if you show those images of these women with naked breasts, the channel would be stopped. In France, it's completely okay, and it's a little bit weird if you would blur it. And we had a very interesting discussion because for the management, the femen was very normal, and we should show it the way it is. And it's until we were stopped by the U.S. Government from broadcasting in the U.S. For infringing their laws, that there was the discussion that we should adapt it. And in the Arabic news channel,
what's the policy of Al Jazeera on this?
No, of course not. Of course not. But us journalists in the Arabic channel, even though we were in France, we would be considered liberals, or we don't have any problem with the nudity, maybe. We felt like the channel is insisting on the point of view of the French local social local media and social acceptance. And for us, what was more important was what these girls are saying, more than showing their breasts. For me, it was we had like several meetings with the management saying that it's not about being conservative or not conservative. I want the lady in her house who's 60 years old to listen to what these girls want. I don't want her to switch the channel just because we decided to show their nudity. And after a while, yeah, they decided that, yes, okay, we blur the naked femen. Because in the end, that's the difference with the French journalism. The idea of the journalism in France is it's a militant journalism. They don't believe in the idea that we can give the news and don't give an opinion. They say we have to give an opinion. We cannot let people die and say, okay, this is the news, we will not be revolted by it, and people can keep dying. For them, it's militancy. For our friends who were in the English Channel, it was being unethical. So it's very interesting, because up until today, I feel like the whole idea of ethics in journalism is not well-defined, and every society has its own point of view. In Al Jazeera, the culture is very different. And sometimes I feel it's not the culture within Al Jazeera, but it's also the audience, especially of Al Jazeera. I'm sure the audience of Al Jazeera, you cannot talk to him about gay
is
marriage.
Is there any example kind of that parallels, let's say, a female experience on Al Jazeera? Hmm. Like if I fast forward you to Al Jazeera newsroom now, have you experienced any, let's say, limitation, any discussions, maybe yeah. any challenges to do with any social or cultural kind of news coverage?
Well, there was recently when Obama actually declared that gay marriage is okay in the U.S., and everyone was putting rainbow colors on Facebook. I don't know if you remember that. It was headlines everywhere, except Al Jazeera. So I came to the news channel. I was like, but this is news everywhere. Everyone is talking about it. This is huge for the first time in the U.S. history. And they said, but this is wrong. We cannot talk about it. So yeah, for me, this is when I realized that I had a producer, and we had also a big meeting at Al Jazeera, whether we should talk about it or not. And we were very divided, because there were people like me who would say that this is news, and for them, maybe it's not wrong or wrong. That's not the issue. The issue is the news. And there were for people, we shouldn't even talk about it. In the end, the management came in, intervened, and we covered it. But it wasn't the headline like everyone else. It was just like a very 15-second news in the end of the bulletin.
So. Yeah, so it was more or less kind of audience-based judgment. This is, you know, our audiences, maybe the yeah. social, cultural, religious parameters wouldn't kind of accept this or receive it.
Which is not very bad, because maybe it's better than some channels who would present the news and then start attacking it and say this is we should fight this and so it's I find it that in the way when the dealing with the society, they are doing the job without trying to push the society into certain areas.
Now, Rawaa, before coming to our audience here, let's talk about the move to Al Jazeera. We have spoken about France 24. And then you moved to Al Jazeera. So what brought you from lovely, bright, joyful Paris to Doha?
I fell in my own trap. I was headhunted. It had to come to an end. But it's better. It's always better, by the way, to get headhunted than to actually try to push for the job. In the beginning, you will push for all the jobs in your life. But then at some point, just try to keep a certain value of yourself and wait to be headhunted for the right opportunity. In the beginning, it was interesting, because when they approached me, I was like, but we are very liberal at France 24. And I basically, in my bulletin, it's everything that Al Jazeera stands against. So it was interesting, because the director told me that this is actually a perception of people. And it's mainly coming because most of the news is, in a way, coming from the same society, same ideas. And that's why they're trying to diversify and recruit new people who are different from who they are at the time being, because they need to renovate. They need new eyes, new pair of eyes. And I don't regret it at all. It was tough to adjust, especially that the presenter in Al Jazeera is the English system. And in the English system, the presenter reads the news. You are free to prepare all the questions and the interview, but you don't actually write the news. Whereas in the French system, you are in charge of your bulletin, so you have to write everything, and you write a kind of editorial in the beginning, which we don't have in the Al Jazeera system and the English system.
And don't forget as well that you have been rescued from freezing Paris.
Yes.
To the warmth of Doha.
A lot of people ask me, does anyone leave Paris for Doha? And actually, at the time when they headhunted me, it was February, they called me and I was just freezing. And I was like, yes, it's sun all year long. I'm going now.
This is very good. Now, another question, just either in Al Jazeera newsroom or France 24 newsroom, was there any kind of emotional moment? And in fact, I found this on the YouTube, and it's very kind of telling. And then I consulted Rawaa before running the clip, if this is okay with her. But let's start with the clip and then hear your comment on it. This is Rawaa doing part of the news bulletin in France 24.
No, this is this. So I still get.
Yeah, just before you speak, Rawaa, this is a news item about explosions and people dying in Tripoli. This is Rawaa's own city in Lebanon.
Well, this was a very interesting episode in my career because we obviously know that we shouldn't cry on air and we shouldn't show emotions, but then it just came in and I couldn't stop it. I just couldn't. It wasn't only that it was about my city. The explosion actually in my cities happened 2 days before this, and it was just that I had lots of very hopeful stories. I was very afraid that when people would start doing explosions in Tripoli, then it's the civil war again in Lebanon. And the way people dealt with it, the way some just brave people just came in the street and said, no, we don't want to fight, we just want to clean, we want to get back to our lives, that was what moved me a lot. Because I was actually on air the day the explosion happened, and I didn't get emotional. I was afraid, I had all my worries in my mind, but I was doing my job. But here, I guess it was the hope stories that I felt like it's still not a very bad world that we're living in today.
Have you cried ever since on screen?
Some people, actually. We had some very emotional news just after that, within the coming 3 months. And some people were calling the channel and saying, why didn't she cry? And I don't cry all the time. I don't do, my job is not crying on air. It was one time, and I had some people who were saying this is completely unprofessional. And I had my director, actually, who supported me, because he said we're just human. And in the end, you don't give us, as professors, you don't give us a course in acting. So I really didn't know how to stop myself.
Something to consider.
I really didn't know how to stop myself. I just couldn't. And I don't know any colleague who didn't burst on laughter or burst in tears on air. Maybe you should consider adding that.
Oh, I thank
but
you
we're
very
humans.
Much
we're journalists. Yeah,
this
all.
Is understandable. Now, ladies and gentlemen, so any questions, any reflections, any inspired thoughts? So the floor is open. Who wants to take the lead? Yep. Go ahead, please. If you can use the mic, though.
Hi, I'm Amira Hariri, the Assistant Director of Admissions. We are coming from the same country, and you were exposed to international experiences and working in two channels which cover the Lebanese news. And you know, we have a lot to say about Lebanon. Haven't you thought to work in one of the leading Lebanese channels? We have a good channels.
We have
they didn't headhunted you.
Thank you, Amira.
We have very good journalists. I love Lebanon, but I love it too much to actually work in any of the existing media. Unfortunately, we have very, very good media, very good journalists, really very professional. But when you're in one channel, you are free to talk about the other, but you're not free to talk about their guys. And we don't have an independent media. When we would have an independent media, other than Télé-Liban, which is very weak in Lebanon, then I would really love to be and to do the French journalism, militant journalism, and be part of it. But so far, I actually hate all Lebanese politicians because I'm against all the system of of dividing between quotas. And I felt like I've been discriminated against because I was coming from a certain sect and not the other. We had enough quota from this sect, and I had to appeal to politicians, and no one really actually convinced me. So no, I wouldn't so far. Maybe one day I would open a channel. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, please, go ahead.
Today with social network and all this internet thing, we have whole fields that are transitioning to other platforms. Do you think it's going to be the case for journalism? For example, is broadcasting not going to be shown on TV anymore?
I am one of the advocates in Al Jazeera for social TV. The director basically just tries to avoid me all the time because I'm saying, when are we moving to social TV? I strongly believe that we are moving in another stage. And the job of a journalist is becoming harder because there are lots of journalists now with you just need a Twitter account and Facebook. I even made a report. I was in Central Africa a couple of weeks ago, and I made a full VT report for TV with my iPhone. So anyone can do a VT now. Anyone can broadcast information. And this is where real journalists have to step in because we have to monitor, we have to filter, we have to do the job properly. And just not anyone who would have a camera can just say any info, any news that could sometimes declare wars between countries. So yes, we are moving, and I think it's a very different. For example, myself, I'm not considered your generation, consider the elder generation. But myself now, I don't watch TV in the sense of TV. I watch YouTube or I watch video on demand. Lots of channels, French channels and American channels, you can actually go for the bulletin you want for this hour and this hour and go back to it. So sometimes when I go to my place, I just watch the news of the morning or the evening, whenever I want, or the show I want. So this is social TV moving to another step. Involving social network users also. But it's also, I think we need lots and lots of programs that involve people who are giving information without being real journalists and then doing the journalism work like in any sources of information.
Okay, thank you, Rawaa. Yes, please go ahead.
Hi, I just wanted to know, as a journalist who's worked both in France and Qatar, which has a lot more segregation, have you felt any sort of discrimination on the basis of your gender, either in the workplace or in the field?
It's a very interesting question, because I actually had more misogynous experiences in France than in Qatar. Here, the society, because it's a conservative society, we have a certain respect for women and certain borders or barriers with women. As a presenter, you don't feel segregated against because it's a job. They want you to be there and to represent the channel, so you don't really feel it. And I would really, not because I'm working with Al Jazeera, but really I was impressed with what they did in the past 2 months. They sent all the female presenters everywhere in the world, and they didn't send men. So no, I don't feel, in journalism, I don't feel that you would feel segregation. It's really about your work, but you would always have some comments about your hair or your makeup. That's normal, I guess, when you're a woman.
And where did they send you?
They sent me to Central African Republic, which basically lots of people don't know where it exists.
In Central Africa, so I guess.
Yeah, it's in Central Africa. Well, it's in the middle of Africa. I actually asked for this mission because I wanted to do some field work, and I don't want to spend my entire year in the studio. And for me, this country is just a forgotten country because no one actually cares about it. It's even the wealth that is in it is exploited by local militias and some traffickers from outside. But it's not even interesting for international community to actually.
I believe it's huge in terms of.
It's huge. It's the size of France and Belgium together.
And the population?
It only has 5 million in terms of population. And it's very widespread. It's really fascinating how it's underdeveloped. I've never seen this in my entire life. We've seen countries going out of wars, but this has not even been developed. In the capital itself, you have like 4 main roads, and I think the last time they've been paved was 20 years ago. I did a series of reports that will be aired starting this week, and I'm trying to push for the English channel also to pass my report. So it's a series of reports about in the capital you have a Muslim community. Most of them fled the capital, but those who decided to stay, they are actually living enclaved or secluded from the rest of the city. So it was hard to go inside and talk to these people. And what was even more interesting is that when we went inside, we found some Christian people who were living with these people, and they were facing the same destiny, just because the other side, it's for them, they're the traitors. So it just really shows that people, it's not about religion, it's just politics, and then they try to push the religion as a tool in it. Mm-hmm. And I did a report about mines. I've been threatened, but I don't take it seriously. I had an interesting threat. I was like, I'm not even scared of Syrian secret services, so I don't think I will be afraid of the Central African secret services. There was someone who came and he said, apparently you're Al Jazeera journalist who went to the mines. You know, when we go to the mines, we discover some things that are upsetting. To know about it, it's okay, but to talk about it, that's not good. You don't want your husband to find himself a widow. And I was like, seriously, no, I'm not going to take you for serious anyway. So, especially that it's very funny, this countries of chaos, the militia who's actually holding the mine are the ones we had to beg and have an official signed letter of let them pass to this area. So I didn't really, and anyway, I didn't do investigative journalism in this area. It was just about children working.
I believe you were attacked by a goat that was part of...
I was just sitting like that, interviewing someone, and he was talking to me about that here we are just a good example of social cohesion, and I get this goat that hits me here, and I tell him, okay, social cohesion is hard here. It's strong.
Okay, more questions, especially from our students? Yes, Osama? Oh, sorry, then I come back to you. Can you use the mic somewhere near to you, please? Thank you.
So when you meet journalists from other TV channels or magazines, newspapers, do you feel that the way they treat you or they approach you changed when you moved to Al Jazeera?
Yeah, I actually have a lot of people, especially in the Arabic side, who would accuse me of being a traitor for being with Al Jazeera. And some people, I don't know, I'm sure you followed the whole story with Egypt and how some journalists, they see Al Jazeera today. What was upsetting for me is that to have journalists who would actually believe the propaganda of regimes. For me, and this is where my master's in mass communication was interesting, because it was more about techniques of propaganda, how to do the shift of scene, when you, let's say, why are you wearing a white shirt? And he would say, but she's wearing green. And he would just change the topic to another side. And for me, this is what Al Jazeera suffered from. She was revealing, okay, they had some political positions, but for me, it wasn't. I was in France 24 talking about the Muslim Brotherhood exactly the same way Al Jazeera was talking, because for me, even if France 24 is liberal, secular system, it's not acceptable that some people are persecuted because of their political views. Whether they're with or with against religious parties, that gives them the right to exist. That doesn't. You can be against them, you can be opposition, but doesn't give you the right to actually persecute people. So some people, to make the shift of scene, instead of talking about the persecution of this political group, which is half of the population almost, they just blame it on Al Jazeera. Like, everything is going in the Arab world, and they're like, Al Jazeera is the one who is causing wars. And I'm like, no, just before Al Jazeera, people were still fighting. And I'm sure if you just turn off the TV, people were still fighting. It's not... Al Jazeera didn't put guns in the hands of people. So yeah, I face this a lot with colleagues, and sometimes I'm emotional, and So, but they give up quickly with me because I keep arguing until they give up. I'm actually proud to say that I have some journalists, Egyptian journalists, who were completely attacking me on my Facebook page, and now they just share my post and they're saying that this is what Al Jazeera stands for. And my friend, colleague showed me yesterday, he said, what are you doing to Egyptian journalists? Are you brainwashing them? But I really think people should understand the difference between what Al Jazeera presents, even with the political positions that sometimes we would have. It's really journalism. It hasn't been away from this line.
Yeah, thank you. Can I see how many hands do we have just in the interest of time? Yes, please.
Yeah, based on what I know, Al Jazeera is permitted to air critical reports on foreign countries, but not reports on Qatar. So how is that different from France 24? Was it the same experience or, like, that's based on what I know. So
when I came to Al Jazeera, I was expecting, I don't even know if this is politically correct to say it, but I will say it, I'm okay with it. I was expecting that we actually receive a guideline every morning from either the Diwan of the Emir or the Ministry of Foreign Affairs telling us what we should talk about and what we should not talk about. To my surprise, it doesn't exist in Al Jazeera, to the point that even when we had, I don't know if you followed the declaration of Riyadh, and there was this whole agreement to repatch the problems with the countries of the region, people at Al Jazeera were like, we really need at this point to have someone from the government to tell us what we should say, and we didn't know whom to contact. So in 18 years, really, what happened with Al Jazeera is that there was no intervention. And a lot of people inside, they actually say it and they prove it and they show me things that show that, yeah, there is no. We actually caused diplomatic incidents to Qatar because we attacked other countries or we criticized other countries. But what happens is, I think it's a gentleman's agreement. Like, we're based here. They are giving us all the freedom they are giving us. So I think it was more of a gentleman's agreement not to talk about Qatar. And I think that more and more, as Qatar is becoming a player and is a player since a couple of years in international community, I think they had to restudy how it's treated and talk about it. It's still, we're still very free to talk. I think sometimes it's more like, for example, when I was in France, no one actually ever came to tell me that when you talk about Palestinians, you cannot say martyrs, and you cannot say, but I knew it. No one had to tell me, because this is the foreign policy of France, to stay like at equal distance from Israelis and Palestinians. But for me, when I was covering the Gaza war, I had to do double the work because I couldn't be reproached by my management of being with this side or the other, but I was obviously with the Palestinians, and I don't deny it. So I had to actually work around the rules. And working around the rules for journalism can be as easy as just doing your research properly. For me, I was just every day, going on Human Rights Watch, going on the UN, just reading all the arguments. And Human Rights Watch, they actually make your life easier in these cases. They give you all the international laws and how Israelis are, for example, not abiding by it. And you would have legal arguments. So even though I was not complying with the French policy, I couldn't be reproached. And I think it's the same everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Rawaa, for this. Any other comments or questions, guys? Our coming female TV presenters, any questions?
You should be ready for the makeup. It's a lot of
Don't scare them, Rawaa. I'm trying to push them to do this. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, Rob, then we are going to go to the final clip before coming to Ev. Yeah?
The last word.
Maybe to go back to the question of culture, and the news of culture, you maybe go back to that, talk a little bit more about sort of from just sort of
in the newsroom, what was the experience of an employee almost? What was your daily life like there as opposed to you?
Yeah, it's actually very interesting because it's completely different from Al Jazeera. In France 24, we actually work the three channels together. Like, I was, as a presenter, I was with my producer, and just facing me, I had the French presenter, and next to us, the English presenter and the producer. So we were working as three teams, and it was more cost-effective also for them because we're working three together. Sometimes we're dividing the work, especially in terms of images. And for us journalists, we were exchanging a lot. There are lots of issues that I wouldn't have understood without them explaining me. Like, there are sometimes some French, very local expressions I wouldn't understand. And they were relying also on me to explain a lot about the Arab world, so I was doing most of the talking, obviously, with everything going on. It's in terms of every department is actually in three languages in France 24. You have the editors-in-chief, they're also three, because they need some time to divide the same live, because they wouldn't have the budget of Al Jazeera to have a live for each channel. So we needed to coordinate a lot. It was way more coordination, and it was more interaction. We would be sometimes doing the same report. I would be doing the Arabic when I was doing the reports as a journalist. I would be doing the Arabic-Syrian, let's say, conflict. I would make the VT of the day. He would be doing the European economic crisis. And I would just take the images and translate it, and he would translate it. So we were saving a lot of time, and we were doing the work of 20 people more, I would say. But for me, it was very enriching because we had also all the different schools people were coming in, people coming from CNN, people coming from BBC, people coming from French television. It was very different, very interesting. Here in Al Jazeera, we have the Arabic channel aside, the English channel is in another building. And even to transfer files, you have it's a lot of work. But now we're moving to more a common base of data, at least. So it could be interesting as a step of integration between the two. But the Al Jazeera is very big. We have a lot of people from lots of nationalities, and I would say it was interesting for me because there were some mentalities that are not at all existing in France 24, and it brought to my eyes more the Arabic audience, to be honest. I felt like in France 24, we were a little bit very detached from the Arabic viewer. We had more the Arabic viewer who's living in France or in Europe, but not really the Arabic viewer as a whole.
Rawaa, thank you very much for sharing with us these clear and strong, I guess, insider views. And then I move to our dean to thank you even further. And maybe invite everybody before this or after this to join me in thanking you.
I I would like to thank you for giving me the chance, because usually all I'm allowed to do is, how do you feel about it? What would you say about that? So now I'm the one saying thank you.
Well, I want to thank you for a real tour de force from France 24 to Al Jazeera and giving us insights into what's happening there, and also for demonstrating such an incredible passion for journalism in the field and for the candor with which you've spoken and all the things you've told us about today, and also for doing something to absolutely shatter the image of an anchor or a presenter as a person who doesn't have opinions and ideas. Mm-hmm. That's not true. So thank you very much. Fabulous job. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is really great.
Thank you.